Right, so we have Dr. Chinmay Tumbe today. He is an assistant professor at Indian Institute of Management, Ahmedabad. And he has been doing some great works on India's migration. And I think his is one of its kind, I mean, he has one of its kind of its of a book which talks about this whole great Indian migration history, so wave of migration. And I know that many students here are interested in migration and they want to work on migration. So this is an excellent opportunity. He has been associated with several distinguished institutions like London School of Economics, Harvard University, right? And he has taught in TIS as well before joining IMA. So I think that's, yeah. So let's enjoy, and he's a very young faculty, so we can, and a very interesting one, right? So let's learn as much as possible from him about migration.
Thank you so much. Thanks a lot. I should mention that Pooja is, it's great to have Pooja here because she's my 1 year senior when we were both doing our PhDs in economics at IIM Bangalore. It's not too far from here. So thanks a lot to Chandan and APU for getting me here. I love to come to Bangalore and I love to talk on this subject, which has kind of kept me awake for now more than 10 years, migration. And now I'm migrating away from this topic on to cities, but obviously they're linked. So I thought after studying migration, it's natural now to start studying cities more closely and the kind of urbanization that's happening. So in this talk, I'm kind of merging two of my big research projects. One is this 10-year research project on migration, which has yielded one book. It's called India Moving, A History of Migration. I'll be talking of some elements of that book. That book has a much wider canvas. There's a book talk today at Champaka bookstore in the evening. If you're interested, come along. And the new project, which has one paper, it's called Urbanization, Demographic Transition, and the Growth of Cities in India, and work that I'm sort of building onto there. And what I'm going to try and give you is a flavor of what's happened, what's happening, and what might happen in the immediate decades coming. This is sort of a macro level analysis. There will be individual level stories and so on, but more or less this is a big picture view of what's happening in India. So there are going to be some maps, charts, etc., alongside some photographs. So let me start right away. The big themes I'm going to explore in the next half an hour, 1 hour, is these five topics. And of course, we know that if you talk about migration and urbanization in India, it is much more than these five topics. But I'm using these five topics as partly as some of the stuff which I've been working on, some of them being my contributions to the field, but more or less because they seem to be underplayed in what we usually talk about migration and urbanization. And I'm going to lead this discussion towards the end to this paradox that we see today within India of slower urbanization and rapid urban growth in the north versus the south. Okay, so there are two words, urbanization and urban growth, and they're two different things. Okay, and that's a very important part of this story. For example, when I started out my work 5 years back, I would start all my papers, research proposals with the word rapid urbanization. This is a word you'll keep hearing again and again and again. Rapid urbanization. India's, the challenges faced to the environment, the challenges faced to infrastructure by rapid urbanization. And if you're based in Bangalore, you will think that, you know, it's an exploding city, that India is urbanizing very rapidly. And one of the big takeaways that I want you to leave this room with is that actually India is not urbanizing rapidly. India is in fact one of the slowest urbanizing major region of the world. And understanding why this is happening is, I think, very, very critical. There's, of course, rapid urban growth, like in Bangalore, but urbanization is a slightly more complex story. So this is the broad outline of what I'm going to do. So let me start with some of my earlier work on migration and why that might be important to understanding migration today. And I'll start this story, you know, about more than 100 years back. This is from the 1870s, it's a picture in the Illustrated London News, which shows you modes of traveling in India. Now this is of course a British projection of what was happening then, but you see people you know, crawling, people on these palkis, people on carts, and of course the symbolic elephant, and then the railway, the train, you know, which really appears in 1853 as this British contribution to increasing the speed of mobility in a big way. Now, the railways was a landmark moment in Indian sort of history. It connected the nation in a variety of ways which are not possible. But it did not really start mobility. Mobility has a much longer history, which I write in my book. Much of mobility was on water, not on land, either by the coastal routes or by riverways. And the railways was anyway not the major institution in the lives of migrant workers. I've argued that that is actually the post office. So postal money order remittances, for example, have been a huge way of sustaining, you know, economies and regions around India. But this is useful just to tell you the region, the sort of time in which we are starting today's talk, which is about the 1870s. 1870 is a very interesting period in Indian history. It's a decade of famines, the great Indian famine of 1876-78. It's a decade of the first All India Census, and because of which we actually for the first time know what is the population of India, how does it look, the demographics, who's migrating, etc. Since then, you know, India's had a census every 10 years, 1881, 1891, 2011, and now 2021. And it's the sort of a decade when Indian sort of globalization really kicks off in a big way. So we are used to thinking of globalization as a post-1991 phenomenon. But any student of sort of world history would know that it's a U-shaped curve. That is, the first real massive globalization wave happened between about 1870 and 1914, onset of the First World War. Then the global economy shrank, especially during the Great Depression of the 1930s, and then started slowly tying up again after 1945, World War II, and then really kicking off from the 70s, 80s, and in the case of India, 1991 being a very critical year. But in India, Indian economic history, 1870 is also very important, because apart from railways, the British were really tying up regions across the world as part of the British Empire. As a result of which, Indians really started moving in large numbers. And you've probably heard this story in terms of indentured migration, people who reached the Caribbean. If you look at the West Indian cricket team, you'll find some people of Indian origin names and so on. But I've argued that the bulk of these migrations, and these were mass migrations, over literally 40 million people from India left Indian shores and went outside. A lot of them came back as well. And they went to places like Burma, Sri Lanka, you know, Singapore, Malaysia. They also went to the Caribbean. This is, in a way, is India's first age of mass migration, first wave of globalization. And of course, this is a period where India's first big metropolitan cities come about. So the first time, arguably, that we have a city of the size of 1 million comes about in the first decades of the 20th century, Calcutta and then Bombay. Bombay overtakes Calcutta across the 20th century. But until then, city sizes in India were usually in the range of 50,000, 100,000. Hampi, people calculated to be about 500,000, right, at its peak glory days. But 1 million is a sort of critical juncture, and that happens only when you're able to produce that many goods and services that can be supplied to a city. That can happen only when certain sort of land use changes happen fundamentally, when you have an elevator, so you can have building sizes go up like you have in this building. And so this is a very interesting period to start the story. It's also interesting because I've argued that this marks the onset of something called as the Great Indian Migration Wave. And I argue that the Great Indian Migration Wave, I'll explain what it is in a bit, is the world's largest and longest voluntary migration system ever seen. Okay, and this is important to put it out there because a lot of people actually start looking at migration in India from the perspective of low spatial mobility. If you look at census numbers today, you will find that outside marriage migration, actually work-related migration, is a really tiny fraction of overall Indian population. If you look at it in comparative perspective with other countries, in fact, the question economists ask is, why is spatial mobility in India so low? Why are people not migrating more? Right? And what I argue is that it depends on how you look at the statistics, but there's absolutely no doubt that for large parts of India, you have this phenomenon of continuous mass migration for several generations. 1870s is a nice time period because it starts off during a wave of globalization, kind of plateaus in the 20th century, and again kicks off post-90s in a big way. And if you saw the census of 2011, which released, the data of census 2011 just released a few weeks back, after 8 years, it shows a massive rise in spatial mobility in India between 2001 and 2011. Okay, but I argue that this is just a continuation of what you've seen in the past. And let me start this story, through a couple of photographs and stories. This is from field work we did in Ratnagiri. This is a family, won't disclose the names, but a family who migrated to Mumbai, the gentleman in the photograph, to work as a security guard in a sort of oil firm, spent his whole life there. This photograph was taken in Chembur, which is a part of Bombay. And that's probably the only time his whole family came, partly to get this photograph clicked, but to kind of visit him in the city. If you see, he has a son who grows up and then takes, because we interviewed him when he was well into his 80s. So this is a photograph, 40, 50 years back. And he recounted that, when he went to Bombay, it was very normal for him to go to Bombay. It was very normal for him to spend 20 years of his life in Bombay. It was very normal for him to return back to his village. And it was very normal for his son to then go to Bombay, not take his job, but take some other job. And this pattern of repeated migration of older cohorts going back, younger cohorts, taking up their jobs, and women not moving unless for the photograph during a vacation, is a remarkable phenomenon in India, but not confined just to this one village. This is another family from a district in India called Udupi. So we talked about Ratnagiri, which is on the coast, but also Udupi, which is a district in South India. And this is a family in the terrace of a house in Mumbai. It happens to be my own family. People are my grandparents and my father sitting out here, photoshopped because he was not born at the time of the photograph. You'll see he looks quite different in attire and so on. But this is a family from Udupi which migrated to Mumbai and actually stayed in Mumbai. Okay, but most families which moved from Udupi to Mumbai actually went back. And the huge segment, of course, are the people who worked in the Udupi restaurants, the most famous, economic sort of export from Udupi. But people who work in Udupi restaurants, if you actually ask them, are you going to settle down in Bangalore? They will actually tell you that, no, we will live here for a long time, 20, 30 years, but we will retire in Udupi, because Udupi is the home. Okay. And in the meantime, the family is back home. There's a remittance economy which is generated because the man is sending back money and so on. Now, Ratnagiri and Udupi are two districts which is with this phenomenal history of mass male migration. And it's best captured by this indicator on sex ratios. Now, all of you, I think students of public policy, development studies, a variety of courses, I think most of you know what a sex ratio is. And the problem in India is one of missing women. Right, that is, you have Beti Bachao campaigns and so on. Sex ratios in India are very low, that is female to male ratios. So if India is on average about 950 to 9,000, in Punjab, in Haryana, that child sex ratios in particular are as low as 700, 800 females to 1,000 males. But what you're seeing in this chart is what has actually never really been documented in a big way. This is not the phenomenon of missing women, it's the phenomenon of missing men. In Ratnagiri and Udupi, sex ratios have never been below 1100 females to 1000 males, not for 1 or 2 years, for over 100 years. Okay, how do you have such a massive demographic imbalance? Okay, is because of mass out-migration, but just not mass out-migration. Mass out-migration which is semi-permanent, because they're not completely settling down, where the fathers return and then the sons also go. This chart starts from 1901 because they are comparable censuses, but this actual figures start from 1872. And we know for Ratnagiri, it really starts from 1872 when the textile mills come up in Bombay. For Udupi, it starts about 1890s. There's a flood in Udupi which sends out a lot of people. Okay. In my book, I talk much more about these districts, the castes which moved out. Almost in all cases, the castes which moved out is what economists call as positive selection, which means the upper castes were the first to move out. This is a migration stream where the lower castes are actually underrepresented. Okay. This is not a migration stream where the poorest of the poor move out first. In fact, it's the richest which move out first. But if you see the standard sort of smattering in Ratnagiri today, it's a migration which today affects all castes. And we've just done a follow-up study on one village which we tracked for over 5 decades using old census records in Ratnagiri. This is a PhD thesis at TIS Bombay. And it's remarkable because you could see in 1961 where the upper caste had a much, much more higher propensity to have a base in Bombay. 50 years later, it's now across castes. Okay? And it has not changed land holdings, but it's completely changed caste dynamics in terms of power relationships, etc. in that village. Now, Ratnagiri and Udupi are two districts. Okay, so is this just a phenomenon of two districts? It's not. I argue that this is a phenomenon of over 200 districts out of 600 odd districts of India. Okay, and those districts are here. This is India's hotspots of out-migration. But these are hotspots of out-migration, not today, but it's been going on for more than 100 years. Okay, so for example, Ratnagiri is this red spot out here. Red means over 25% of households has somebody outside who's gone out for work. Okay, and Udupi is a district here, which is also in red. But Udupi, Ratnagiri are two districts. Then you have the massive west coast starting from Kerala to Ratnagiri on one side of the Western Ghats. You have this massive Gangetic, you know, Western Bihar, Eastern UP belt. You have parts of coastal Orissa. You have the hill economies, Uttarakhand, Himachal. You have northern Rajasthan and pockets of central India. But you see there's a big gap in the entire central sort of, you know, Deccan India, where there's not that much out migration compared to other places. So in Karnataka, for example, there's a world of a difference if you go to Udupi, Dakshin Kannada, versus if you go up to, say, Mysore. Okay. In Mysore, there's not that much out migration. Whereas in Udupi, in South Canada, you find basically virtually, you know, half of households has somebody outside. And this people being outside is not just limited within India, but they could be also outside India. For example, working in the Gulf. So when you think of Kerala as being as a remittance economy, that is a huge part of its workforce out in the Gulf, it's not just Kerala. It's just the entire West Coast on one side of the Western Gulf. And in my book, I sort of look at the history of how these migrations started. They started through a connection with Bombay through steamer routes. It's not really the railways. But in many places, they started through connections either with, say, jute in Calcutta or textiles in Bombay. So specific histories. But what this has created and what this has meant is that there are specific networks, caste-based networks in occupations, which lead to certain sort of patterns in migration movement. Which means, for example, the entire jute industry of Calcutta over 100 years came to be dominated by just one or two caste groups from one district of Bihar called Sar. That's how strong the migration corridors get built. Okay, this is to give you a sense of this strong migration networks. This is a heat map of Bombay. It's slightly outdated data in the sense it shows you migrants who came to Bombay in the 90s. So the map shows you who is coming to Bombay in the 1990s, and it'll show you that you'll see this whole gap in Madhya Pradesh. There are so many more people coming from Eastern UP to Bombay than Madhya Pradesh. Now, standard sort of distance theory would tell you that the closer you are, the more likely you should be there. But it doesn't happen. Okay? You have this one district in Tamil Nadu called Tirunelveli, massive migration to Bombay, other districts of Tamil Nadu with no connection. Okay? So this is how migration happens. It doesn't happen in a vacuum. It happens through a network. It happens through people you already know. And that is why who are the first people to go? It could be a chance shock, it could be a famine, it could be a flood, it could be the British came there and recruited you. Okay, matters tremendously in explaining today's migration decisions. Okay, so Madhya Pradesh was completely locked out of British recruitment networks and in a way is a latecomer to this story. On this chart, you'll also see certain circles. These are circles of seasonal migration. This is hotbeds of seasonal migration. And they're two completely different kinds of migrations. In the Great Indian Migration Wave, the upper castes are more likely to participate in it. There's going to be more remittances. You're unlikely to see contractors, for example. You'll see recruitment based through own family networks. In seasonal migrations, which are much of India's today's brick kiln, construction, agriculture and harvest work, it's the poorest who are more likely to migrate. They'll usually migrate for 2 or 3 months. It is an overrepresentation of scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, and the sort of source regions are quite different. Okay, so northern Karnataka, for example, Mehbub Nagar, this whole belt, you have a belt in southern Orissa, in Chhattisgarh, and this, for example, the city I'm based in, Ahmedabad, sources a lot of its construction labor from this region adjoining Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, and Gujarat. So two completely different kinds of migrations happening in India, this being much more recent and the red ones being much more older, and the red ones having much more money flowing into those districts. So Kerala, for example, if Kerala was a country, it would be a country with the highest remittance to GDP ratio, just to give you a figure like that. Okay, this is to show you Delhi drawing in people from the Gangetic plains. So Bombay being India's most cosmopolitan city, because it draws in people from all over. Why? Because of these histories, because of the historical networks of why, for example, some Muslim weavers from particular districts settled down in, you know, handloom and powerloom centers around Bombay, then started moving to Bombay. And so you have this massive network from eastern UP to here. One district in Kutch, you know, Kutchy sort of traders in Bombay rule the retail space for small shops. Again, chance migrations, complete domination of particular sectors by that caste, and continuing migrations over time. This is Kolkata, which you'll see is much more confined to the eastern half. It draws in migrants in the 1990s, at least, just from its immediate neighborhood. And this is Surat. Surat is a city which I studied at fair length during my PhD. It is India's fast, it is a, one of the world's fastest growing cities. Okay, it grew at about 6% per annum in terms of population growth. And you'll see Surat gets a large part of his labor from one or two districts in coastal Orissa. Right? So all of India, nobody's going to Surat, and then just one or two districts, massive migration. This is urban growth. Surat, this is a map just showing you where people are going to Surat from. Right? So urban growth. And why this connection? Again, interesting history. So in this case, Ganjam being this district in Orissa, and Ganjam being a part of this great Indian migration wave, sent out people to Burma. So this is a massive connection with Burma between, you know, 1870s and 1940s. And then once the Burmese sort of kick out the Indians, you know, in the 1940s, 50s, this network starts to shift, and they sort of, you know, get hold of certain sectors in Surat. But today the entire powerloom industry, the labor force, is pretty much manned by Odia sort of workers. Okay. What this means is that if there's a shock to the Surat economy, that sort of ripple effect is felt in faraway Ganjam, right? Because remittances dry up. The economy of Ganjam itself today is centered around money coming from outside. Okay, money coming from migrants, just like Kerala is, you know, heavily remittance based. Okay, now the implication of this is that this great Indian migration wave, which is semi-permanent, remittance based, and male dominated, has also left its imprint on sex ratios of cities, which means some of India's leading cities, not Bangalore, but leading cities like Delhi, Mumbai, Kolkata, started off as pretty much being male ghettos. You had sex ratios of something like 500 females to 1,000 males. Okay? And this is reflected today's infrastructure. For example, if you look at the number of public toilets for men and women, unequal. If you look at standard surveys on women's sort of mobility within cities, unequal. It is again very closely related with the Great Indian Migration wave. Who first came to these cities? And you see, for Surat, you see the sex ratio stabilizing, because at least a few people are born in the cities over time. So daughters also are born, and so the sex ratio starts to stabilize. But in Surat, the minute the mass migration wave starts, the sex ratio starts to plummet. Okay, similar with Bangalore, though not as dramatic as Surat. Bangalore's sex ratio has been falling because of male migration, but in the south, migration has been relatively more gender balanced. So the question to ask is, what explains the regional variation in the Great Indian Migration Wave? And I've argued that there are some historic recruitment networks that triggered it. And why has it persisted over time? And to me, the answer seems to lie in source region gender norms as to who can move and why cannot the woman also move with the man. And because you all are students of who do a lot of comparisons, the classic country to compare India's experience with is China. And if you see the standard images of China, right, or the manufacturing hubs and so on, you'll see that all those hubs actually are, the huge amount of workforce is female. Okay, which means in China, this massive, China has had the world's largest migration episode in the last 30 years, that the rural to urban migration. The hundreds of millions of people in China who moved away from farms to factories or other jobs have been men and women. Okay. This means that there's been a sort of more permanent redistribution of labor from rural areas to urban areas. Whereas in India, the major sort of distribution for at least work, marriage is a different reason for migration in which women predominate, but on work-related migration, it is heavily, heavily male dominated. The numbers in most places are more than 80% of the flow is male. Okay, in China, it's almost gender balanced. Now, this has huge implications for urbanization, which I'll come to in a bit, as to why might India be urbanizing slowly because of this. Okay, but the intuitive answer is simple. It means that though we sort of cry that there's lots of migration, for example, Bangalore's growth has been because of a lot of migration. Overall in India, while there's a lot of rural to urban migration, there's also a lot of urban to rural migration. Okay, a lot of that is of course return migration. As a result of which, net rural to urban migration in India is actually not that high. In fact, the growth rate of the statistic has been falling over the past 3 decades. Okay. And the question to ask is, why is it that people are not permanently living in India's cities? Okay. One explanation I give is, of course, source region gender norms. So women could also, if you ask people why has your migrant work in a city, why has your wife not moved to the city, they will standard explanations will include, somebody has to look after my family and land back home. Two, what will she do in the city? Three, it's unsafe. Some of the standard explanations when you ask migrant workers. The other side is, of course, the destination side itself. That is what economists would call as, diseconomies of agglomeration. That is, a lot of congestion means that cities become unattractive. So you want to go to the city to earn money, but you also want to go back eventually to lead a nice sort of life of retirement. So what this means is that a lot of migration strategies in India are based towards working, earning, and investing not in the city, but back home. And back home could mean a village or a smaller town in UP, Bihar, or wherever people are coming from. Okay, and that's going to take me to a point on remittance flows and business opportunities. Okay, so this idea of male-dominated work-related migration means that India is actually following what I call masculine urbanization. India is one of the few countries in the world, this is a 45 degree line showing urban and rural sex ratios, each dot being a country. Most countries of the world have a relatively more masculine urban sex ratio than a rural sex ratio. India is opposite, India is out here, and almost all districts of India, fall out on this line. You'll find districts so extreme where the urban is very, very more masculine than the rural. Okay. So this is a peculiarity of India's urbanization process. And this happens for two reasons. One is migration, but the other is also son preference. Okay. So if you look at child sex ratios, also this phenomenon appears. So child sex ratio cuts out a lot of the migration effect, because most migration happens in this age group of 20 to 35. But child sex ratio is also urban areas, much higher degree of son preference exhibited than rural areas. Okay. So as a twin effect, what you get is that Indian cities on average have much more males than females than rural areas. Okay. Now a lot of this was on the migration of labor, which means people moving for work, etc. But there's also the migration of capital. And how does that happen? You probably heard of investment flows, FDI, FII, some of these concepts. Remittance flows are also important ways of capital transfers, because a lot of this money could, in theory, be invested. But it also happens through the physical migration of people who are so-called capitalists. So what this means is, and this is sort of work I started doing after my PhD, is to look at the migration patterns of the people who are standardly in India associated with entrepreneurship or creating new business opportunities. And it's amazing how even today in India, top management is kind of dominated by just a handful of castes and communities, right? So the standard ones being the Marwadis, you can say broad Banya sort of combined, Marwadis, Gujaratis, Parsis. This is a sort of map which shows you some of these originations, but Marwar, Marwadi, Gujarati, Kachi, Sindhi, Chettiars, historically very dominant in South Indian business, not so much today, and the Parsis straddling on this coast, right? But these five groups actually come, less than literally 3% of India's population, 70% of India's 100 richest business leaders even today are from this list, 45% of the 10,000 leading directors of India who belong to India's 1,000 largest companies, 45% of them still belong to this community. And so understanding their migration networks is very interesting. Okay, so in the book, I sort of chart out the migration of Marwadis, why they went to certain places. Now, why is this important in a story on migration and urbanization is because you get these uneven injections of capital based on the migrations of these particular communities. Okay. So, Bihar and Eastern UP got very few Marwadis and Gujaratis compared to many centers in South India, and as a, or for that matter Western Maharashtra, as a result of which you had much more investments in from money lending to irrigation to a lot of works purely based on the migration of these communities. Now, there's one part of the story which is within India. The more fascinating part is actually outside India. Right? And this is a map which just shows you where Indians have gone sort of outside India. About half of this story, or less than half of the story today, is labor migration. For example, the Gulf. Right? So UAE has now 3 million Indians. In fact, in a lot of Gulf countries, literally 80% of the population is immigrant. More than half the population is Indian origin. But in the Gulf, you can't settle down. So by definition, it's circulatory, it's remittance based, etc. But if you look at the top, what I call the three U's or the U-turn, USA, UK, and UAE, this is not just labor migration anymore. Even UAE has a huge proportion of Indians which work in sort of service sector, white collar, so-called white collar professions. In this map tells you, you know, this massive bubbles of US, UAE, UK especially, and also Saudi Arabia, a lot of money flows back from there. $70 billion is the number, overall international remittances. The point is about half of this money goes directly to households as sort of household level transfers. But about half of this are actually withdrawals from NRI deposits. And almost all the NRI deposits of India are based in metropolitan cities. Okay. What this means is that there are literally about $30 billion flowing in the major metropolitan cities of India from Indians who are not in India but outside India. And that has, you know, huge implications for how cities are imagined. You have the dollar colonies and NRI colonies in Bangalore, for example. It's important to understand because standard, if you're a student of migration and urbanization, you tend to focus your geographical imagination to India. But a lot of stuff which is changing India's landscapes in both rural and urban areas is coming from money coming from abroad. Some of it could be FDI, corporate FDI, but a lot of it is migrant transfers. Okay, so remittance being $70 billion, so almost 2 to 3% of India's GDP, it's a massive volume. Okay, and this is not going evenly into India. It goes to the principal metropolitan cities, and that is why you have such massive injection. Why the big cities are growing much faster than the others is because they have this huge injection of flows coming from migrants. But if you look at labor transfer or sort of household level transfers, you'll see that this is the map. So Kerala gets a lot of the money, North Rajasthan, Punjab, a few districts of Punjab. Again, this is a lot of people think Punjab has this huge, you know, connection with Canada and other places. It's a few districts of Punjab which have this massive connection. You have some parts around Hyderabad today. And now Eastern UP and Bihar have entered the sort of international migration story also. So there are more labor migrants from UP and Bihar today than even from Kerala going to the Gulf. So that's the big change which has happened in the last 5 or 10 years. Okay. So what this means is that India has this remarkable international, what you know, it's called transnational business connections through migration networks, which have led it to remittance flows. It has also led to the growth of the IT and health sector. You cannot understand sort of Bangalore's growth as this IT hub without understanding the international emigration of Indians to the US, the links cultivated between US and Bangalore by Indians themselves, and then starting up many of these businesses in Bangalore or Hyderabad or Pune or Chennai. Right? And the reason why these few cities have gone way ahead in terms of growth rates is because of these international connections. Okay? As a result of which, both FDI and remittance flows have been concentrated only certain parts of India. The quickest proxy is states which have a coastline, so Gujarat and you know Maharashtra and this whole belt, and Delhi, Gurgaon. This has sort of got the bulk of India's FDI plus remittance flows, leading to tremendous regional sort of imbalanced development. So if you look at India's regional development map today, there is absolutely no doubt that in the last 40 years, regional disparities have grown. Okay, but this has not just been grown because of, you know, FDI. A lot of this has also been because of the networks that Indian migrants themselves have cultivated outside India. So I'm going to come now to this point on slow urbanization. Okay, and this is sort of it links up with what I've been saying so far. And I'm going to argue that India, A, is not urbanizing rapidly. So what is urbanization? And provide an exponential as to why this is happening, which perhaps you have never thought about. Okay? Because when you think of urbanization, you think of migration. Okay? But there are some other forces at work as well. And I'm going to talk a lot about fertility and mortality. Okay? Because these are important demographic channels through which urbanization happens. Now, urbanization as a definition is very simple. It's the share of population which lives in urban areas. Now, how do you define what is urban is a million-dollar question in India. And I say $1 million because you could lose $1 million if you become rural or urban. Because you lose access. If you're rural, you get access to Manrega funds. If you're urban, you don't. Right? So there's a whole political economy on classification of what is rural and urban in India. Having said that, you probably know the definition of what is urban. Either it is classified as an urban area by the state government, or it has to have there's a sort of threefold classification. Right? So there's a population threshold, there's a density threshold, and there's a sort of occupational threshold of having 75% of the male main workforce as being non-agricultural. Now, as per this definition, in India's urbanization in 2011 was 31%. In that same year, China's was more than 50%. Okay. So one could argue that India's urbanization is very low with respect to China. But as we'll see, it's actually low with respect to many other countries in the world. But you could argue that this is just purely a quirk of definition. Suppose we use some other definition, India could be 50% and so on. Okay. And then I'll try and convince you as to why, irrespective of looking at any definition, you cannot escape the fact that India is urbanizing slowly, and there's a very, very simple explanation, which is not rooted in migration. So some historical perspective on urbanization. This is a chart from 1700 to 1960. This is how industrial Europe urbanized. Okay, so they moved from about 20% urban to 80% urban over a long period of time, okay, almost over 150 years. Whereas you'll see, this is a different time scale, 1900 to in about 100 years, the other parts of the world have urbanized much more quickly. Okay, so one is industrial Europe being sort of the benchmark in development studies as the sort of first in Europe, UK to be the first to have the industrial revolution and so on. They urbanized over a much longer time period, whereas most of the world is urbanizing much more quickly. So that's true. It also shows you that growth rates of urban areas have been much higher in other parts of the world compared to industrial Europe. Now, this gray line shows you the urbanization again of so-called developed regions, and you'll see that virtually every region is urbanizing faster than the gray line, except South Asia, and South Asia is pretty much India. Okay. Which means that India or South Asia is different not only from other parts of the world, it's also different from industrial Europe developed regions in urbanizing much slower. Okay. So here's the real puzzle. Compared to Brazil, compared to Africa, urbanization, the share of total population that is urban, is actually very low as per some definition and doesn't seem to be growing too fast. Okay. So why? So one is, of course, as we say, there's a slow pull of agricultural employment. And if you look at other countries in the world, as you get richer, countries are more urban. It's one of the most stylized facts of development studies. But you'll see that India falls below this line. Okay, so for its level of per capita income, India should be much more urban than it is, but it's a sort of a mystery. Okay. Then of course there are the regional variations in urbanization in India. So this is a chart from 1901 to 2011, and it shows you Tamil Nadu and Bihar, two completely contrasting stories. One, both starting from, Tamil Nadu was more urban even in 1901, but you'll see the dramatic differences today, where Tamil Nadu is almost 50%, and Bihar is still at 10%. Right? So Bihar moves from 5% to 10% over 110 years, whereas Tamil Nadu moves from about 12% to nearly 50% in the same time. Okay, so dramatic differences even within India on the pace of urbanization. Okay, and this is how urbanization would look today. If you mapped it at a district level, this massive gaping hole out here, which doesn't seem to be too urban, whereas in many other parts in this Salem corridor, in the Bombay-Surat corridor, in the Delhi-Jaipur corridor, fairly urban. Okay, urbanization in India is strongly related with per capita incomes, correlation coefficient almost 0.9, which means richer states of India are more urban, etc. Okay, So I'm going to come quickly to this definition. So if you change the definition of what constitutes as urban, you can actually pull up India's urbanization rate from 31% to almost 47%. Okay. But the point is, if you want to see change over time, you need to use the same definition across time. And if you do that, if you change the definition for all time periods, you'll see that between 2011, the difference is only of 3 percentage points. Okay. So irrespective of what definition you use, okay, you can maybe bump around the absolute level of urbanization in India, but there's no getting around the fact that India's urbanization change is 3 percentage points per decade. Okay. And if you look at literally any other country in the world, the global average is 6 percentage points per decade. In China, it's been literally 10 or more percentage points per decade. Okay. So India's change in urbanization is remarkably slow, irrespective of what definition you use. And a lot of people, there's one line of argument which says that if this is the case, it must mean that Indians are not migrating to cities and there must be some barriers to migration. Maybe there are linguistic barriers. People from the north cannot move to the south, okay, and so on. It turns out that there's a much more simple explanation for this, okay? And that's rooted in India's demographic transition. Okay, so if you're students of development studies, you should be knowing this chart. What this chart tells you is India's, you know, grand, you know, population growth rate story. Death rates in India started plummeting after 1921. Okay, we have this famous influenza epidemic of 1917. Birth rates take time to catch up, and so they start falling only from the 1960s. In between, natural growth rate starts to peak. Okay, this is called the demographic transition. That's the reason your grandparents had, you know, 8 or 9 siblings, whereas you probably have 1 or 2, or you're probably like me, the only child. Right. So this massive swing happens because of certain processes at work. Now, India's peak population growth is already in the past. That was about 2% per annum population growth that peaked in the 1980s, and today we are growing at about 1.5% per annum. Okay. What's interesting and what's not been known is that these processes have been quite different in rural areas and in urban areas. Okay. So I'll skip on this. Okay. So what I call as the demographic divergence, okay, is this difference in the movement of natural growth rates. Natural growth rate is fertility minus mortality between rural and urban areas. Okay. And this is the big chart. Okay. So this is the big takeaway on the idea of demographic divergence. That is, until the 1970s, rural areas and urban areas were growing at the same rate naturally. Okay, which means that it has always been the case that in rural areas in India, birth rates are higher, but death rates are also higher. So the balance has been the same. But in the last 40 years, there's been a dramatic divergence. What this means is that if you didn't have migration, if you didn't have reclassification, India, forget urbanization, India is actually de-urbanizing. Okay, what, I mean, to make us maybe a simpler sort of illustration of this, think of two buckets, a rural bucket labeled rural, bucket labeled urban. And you have two taps, okay, and you have a pipe which goes from rural to urban mostly. Okay. What this is saying is that the rural tap is open at a much higher rate than the urban tap. So despite this transfer from rural to urban areas, there are more people being created on average in rural areas than in urban areas. Okay. And fertility rates in urban areas have actually crashed in the last 20 years. So many towns and cities of India are actually growing at very, very small population growth rates today. Okay. What this means is that in the absence of migration, India is de-urbanizing. So you need migration just to hold on to existing levels of urbanization. If you get more than that, then India will start seeing more share of its population in urban areas. This phenomenon has not really been observed in many other countries of the world. Okay, and definitely not in China. Okay, it has also not been seen in South India, okay, as this chart shows you. So this is a chart on all India divergence, but in South India, in Andhra Pradesh, Karnataka, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, you see that both these rates go down the same. Rural, urban, natural growth rates go down the same. Okay, it's basically in Rajasthan, UP, Bihar, Assam, West Bengal, Madhya Pradesh, where these big divergences happen, and these affect all India rate. What this also means is that South India has urbanized much faster because the rural and urban taps are open at roughly the same proportions. Whereas in much of northern hinterland India, the rural tap is open at a much higher rate than the urban tap. Or anyway, as it's being closed, the urban tap is being closed much more faster than the rural tap. Okay. So if you see these differences more closely, it turns out that districts with a lot of agricultural stagnation, with low agricultural productivity, low agricultural yields in general, have tend to sort of seen these large rural-urban differences in fertility. So I'm not going to show you the empirical analysis, but what it seems is that agricultural yield seems to matter tremendously. Now, we all know that agricultural yields are important to support farmers' livelihoods, etc. But there's a very interesting connection to urbanization. The richer you are as a farmer, the fewer kids you're going to have, okay? Which means that the region as a whole is more going to urbanize more fast. Why? Because urbanization is urban population by total population, and total population includes urban and rural population, okay? So what this means is basically agricultural prosperity is in a way the quickest way to actually urbanize in an area, because fertility in rural areas starts falling much faster. Okay, the minute you have agricultural stagnation, you actually have less urbanization because more people are being created in rural areas. It's a very funny way of looking at agricultural prosperity and urbanization. Now, you might think that agricultural prosperity will actually reduce migration, so people won't need to come to cities and so on. But there is literally no evidence in India which suggests that. What can change is the quality of migration. So seasonal migrations become more longer, better quality migrations. But in India, the historical evidence is that as regions prospered agriculturally, whether in Punjab or coastal Andhra being a classic case, more people moved out. Okay. In coastal Andhra, you know, got the canals, became very prosperous. People started moving to towns, people started moving to Hyderabad, and eventually the US. Right? And the joke, of course, there is that if you dig the bore well deep enough, you know, you can reach US, because that's the ultimate destination for a lot of people out there. Okay, so this is one important aspect of India's urbanization story. Nothing to do with migration, just about fertility. And what drives fertility often is incomes. That is, the richer you are, the fewer kids you're going to have. The more educated you are, the fewer kids you're going to have. These are sort of stylized facts in the development literature. Okay. Then there's some stuff on migration, which I'm going to skip because I'll talk more. But I'll just hit on this one particular slide, which looks at rural-urban migration dynamics. And I just want you to focus on these two numbers here, 78 and 78, 78 million. What this argues is that 78 million people moved from rural to urban areas between 2001 and 11. This is data which got released just last month. It was the census 2011 data on migration, came out after 8 years. So 78 million people moved from rural to urban areas. 78 million people also moved from urban to urban areas. Okay, and this is a very important part of India's current migration dynamic. There were as many people moving from rural to urban areas and urban to areas. In most countries' development experiences, the big shift that happens is that people start moving from rural areas to urban areas, and that number is usually much, much higher than urban to urban migration, like in China, for example. Hundreds of millions of people moved out of agriculture. And this, you know, is a truly remarkable phenomenon for India, as a result of which you can see a difference in cities in India. Just if you look at the metric of what percentage of migrants are coming from rural areas versus what percentage of migrants are coming from other urban areas. And so Bangalore, for example, happens to be that Indian city where more than 50% of migrants come from other urban areas, right? Whereas Bombay or Surat is a classic case where 70% of the migrants come from other rural areas. So if you're looking at a larger development story, Surat does much more in a way for India than Bangalore in terms of overall transformation, okay? Because more people are being affected by the money generated in Surat in rural areas, whereas the money going out from Bangalore through remittances, etc., is going through to mostly to other urban areas themselves. Okay, so this is an important way to look at cities. And so, for example, Delhi, Surat, Bombay are three of the top 10 cities of India with a substantial part of its workforce coming from other rural areas. If you look at Hyderabad, Pune, Bangalore, Chennai, more than 50% of its migrants come from other urban areas. They're two completely different classes of cities. And you see it in the way settlements, so it's not surprising when you say more than 50% of Bombay's population is in slums compared to say 20% in Bangalore based on similar definitions. It's because of the character of migration is completely different. Okay. Now the wealth created is arguably of much more use for the countryside from coming from Bombay than in Bangalore. So this is a very interesting statistic, and you'll see that this has happened for the first time in this decade. Earlier, rural to urban was much higher than urban to urban. And so this is one of the new developments that we are seeing in data just released 3 weeks back or 4 weeks back. Historically, if you look at urban growth, the contribution of this black, which is natural increase, was much more, which means cities of India generally grew because of fertility. This is another thing, another sort of counter. You might think that cities grow because of migration. More than 50% of the increase was natural growth. Okay, but today that's changed. Now migration matters a bit more. Why? Because fertility rates have crashed. So you have that much less pressure coming from within city sort of dynamic than from outside cities. Okay, one way to understand this is this chart, which looks very messy and you'll not understand. So let me explain to this. Basically, you take population growth rates from 1880, one of the first censuses, to now, and you break it into time periods. So the first graph shows you a distribution of growth rates between 1881 and 1921. And this x-axis tells you the annual population growth rate, and this gives you a distribution. So what this is telling you is that the average is zero. So the average city of India basically did not grow at all between 1881 and 1921. Some cities grew positively, some cities actually fell population. Since 1921, when India's death rate started to fall, this distribution moved to phase number two, which is basically 1921 to 1951. Then it moved to phase number three. So each phase, basically population growth rates of the average city is increasing. And then in the last phase, which is 91 to 2001, it's actually sliding back to the left, which means the average city today is growing slower than what it was in the past in terms of percentage growth rates. So this is again another one of those counterintuitive things that A, you might think India is rapidly urbanizing, it is not. B, you might think that cities are growing faster today than ever in the past, it's not. The average city is now growing slower than what it was in the past because fertility rates have fallen. Okay. There are, of course, there's a long tail out here, which means a city like Bangalore lands up out here. Okay. But Bangalore is not the average Indian city. Bangalore, Surat are the outliers which are growing exponentially fast. Okay, but the average city of India is actually growing slower than in the past. In Calcutta, you'll be surprised to know there are wards in Calcutta where the population fell between 2001 and 2011. Okay, in Bombay's island cities, population fell between 2001 and 2011. So this idea that all cities are growing, you know, very, very fast is also not. There are a few clusters which are growing extremely fast, but on average, actually, cities' growth rates of India are falling. And this chart sort of tells you four different kinds of cities. So cities can grow because of natural growth or net migration. Okay, there are only two ways it can grow. There is also area reclassification which can happen. Now, a city like Surat is growing because of both. It has high fertility, it has high migration. So it's growing at about 5% per annum. A city like Bhubaneswar has lower fertility but mass migration. Okay, a lot of government jobs are there, so people are flocking. A city like Sambhal, which is in a town in UP, it's growing at 2% per annum, which is higher than India's overall growth rate. There's virtually no migration, but it has extremely high fertility. Right? So just on its own account, so there are four different kinds of cities. This is the explosive city. This is growing because of internal growth. This is growing because of external growth, and this is just stagnation. There's low fertility and no migration. In fact, Kolkata has net out migration. Okay, so Kolkata's growth rate is just 0.7% per annum, half the national growth rate. So this is a useful way of seeing Indian cities on the metrics of migration and fertility. And you'll see that overall there's no relationship between fertility and migration. Okay. Now what's interesting out here is, as cities get more educated, Bangalore is a fairly educated city among other cities of India, there's a relationship on both. The more educated city that you are, the more sort of innovation, the more sort of skills that you have, the fewer kids you're going to have. So fertility falls, but you're going to be able to draw in more migrants. Okay. Whereas a town like Sambhal has very low education levels, human capital levels, but it has very high fertility, but low migration. Okay. It's still growing at a very fast clip. 2% per annum is a fast clip. So different ways of looking at city growth. Each has their own implication. For example, housing. Now, in which city of India would you invest a lot in housing? It depends on which kind of city it is. Okay? Because when new migrants are coming, they're looking for new housing stock. Whereas internal growth means that it could be the same houses division, okay, or lesser pressure for new housing. So broadly, I'm going to sort of wrap up here. This is a chart on fertility on the city level, but you'll see Kolkata has one of the lowest fertility levels. Towns of North India in general have, you know, fairly high fertility levels. So broadly in India, there's a north-south divide today, okay, which means towns in the north are growing much faster than the south, purely on account of fertility. Okay, and fertility is a function of income, education, and so on. So I'll wrap up here. What I've tried to do is basically integrate two of my research strands, migration and cities. A, if you thought India is rapidly urbanizing, think again in terms of what is urbanization. For example, Bangalore has very high rapid urban growth. The villages around Bangalore are very quickly being submerged within Bangalore, so they are being urbanized very quickly. But India as a whole is urbanizing very slowly. It is urbanizing slowly because of low net migration. A lot of people coming to cities, but also a lot of people going back, rooted in source region gender norms. It is also urbanizing slowly because fertility in rural areas remains very high. Okay, and somewhat counterintuitively, you know, the road to more urbanization starts from agriculture. The minute you have more agricultural prosperity, you're actually going to see fertility drops in rural areas and more urbanization, and quite likely more migration of longer duration kinds. Okay. This idea of remittance urbanism is basically this idea that a lot of cities have become sites of just sending back money out. So Dubai is a classic city. Most people who work in Dubai, they send back money. You know, they're living there, but they're sending back money to the source region. So Bombay is a classic city, a remittance city. Site for remittances, Surat is another one, and so on. Okay. So some ideas on possible futures. What this means is, if you think of which cities are going to grow very fast in the future, we know for a fact that the northern cities on average are growing much faster than cities in the south. Okay, that's purely on account of fertility. But there will be some one or two cities in each cluster which are growing a bit more. That's because they're able to attract skills, talent, like Bangalore, for example. And so I'll leave you with this urban paradox, which is that India has rapid urban growth, but slower urbanization in the north. Why? Because the towns and cities are growing fast, but the villages are growing even faster. Right? So there's actually not much change in urbanization. In the south, you have slower urban growth, but the village is also growing very slowly. And so overall urbanization is much quicker. Okay, so these are the two ways of looking at north and south India in today's. So I'll end here. This is the book which I've written. This is a social media handle which I run on history. And I also conduct a history internship at IMA, two months, especially for master's and PhD students. If you're interested in working anything on exploring business economic history, you can just Google this, the flyers online. We've had tremendous students, you know, interning with us in the past, spent 2 months pretty much exploring a research idea, and hopefully come out with something nice. Okay, so I'll end here and time for some questions.
Thanks. One is that I think the aspect you're saying about, you know, urbanizing slowly is a relative concept. So as we have been urbanizing over the last 40, 50 years, there is a tip, and in terms of, you've possibly not looked at that lens as to urbanization versus infrastructure available for urbanization. When you look at it from that lens, having urbanized for 40, 50 years, somewhere India's turned the curve where at whatever rate it is urbanizing, it is extremely difficult to manage in terms of the urban cities. So when we say that it's slowly urbanizing, I mean, we have not made a nuanced statement. It's purely from a number point of view, right? Second point, I think, is that where the lens you might have, this book might not have covered, is that over the last 50 years of Indian economy growing, the manufacturing and the agri sector grew first, And in the last 10, 20 years, it is the service sector which has grown. And the migration due to the service sector is primarily urban to urban. It's not rural to urban. And that could be one of the major contributing factors other than fertility, which has led to these sort of numbers. Right? So, but I didn't hear you talking about that aspect. So it's not only fertility, but the rate of urbanization is reduced because the service sector has grown and not the manufacturing and sector in the urban cities. The manufacturing sectors have by and large not grown at the same sort of rate they were growing in the 90s. In 2011 they have the manufacturing growths have reduced in terms of over the 60s and 70s. So that's the limited point I thought that.
Excellent points. I'll address both. The first one, when you say India is rapidly urbanizing, it is a statement in relative comparison. So when we say India is rapidly urbanizing, either you're comparing with India's own past urbanization. There is no evidence to suggest that is happening. If you dissect urbanization numbers anyhow, there is no way you can say India is urbanizing rapidly more today than in the past of India's own thing. That is one. And if you compare it with other countries, then there's again no evidence. But what your point is, relative to infrastructure, we feel that it is urbanizing very fast because it, clearly infrastructure has not kept pace. And I think that is the intuitive sense in which people use this statement that India is rapidly urbanizing. But again, this idea that the infrastructure has not kept pace, it really was a strong constraint in the 80s and 90s when population growth rates peaked. As I said, population growth rates today in cities, not Bangalore, but the average city is now lower, much lower than in the 1980s. Right? So overall, urban growth rates have fallen from the peaks of the 1980s. Urbanization within India, whether you look at India's immediate past or whether you look at other countries, has also not been rapid in any sort of relative sense. And so that is why I'm questioning this usage of the phrase rapid. One can argue that infrastructure, but the thing with, again, from the lens of history, I like to use this thing, in the sense of 1891, the mayor of Bombay said that Bombay is too big. We cannot handle so many people. And so that's 1891. It's 500,000 people in Bombay. Today there are 20 million people. So this idea that what we have and what we can absorb, this mismatch in history is tremendous. People clearly, that mayor clearly could not have imagined Bombay of 20 million people, just like the mayor today or the municipal cooperator cannot imagine Bombay of say 30 million even 20 years time. And so I think it boils down to a fundamental mismatch in anticipation of urban growth. I should also add here, I think what's going to happen in the next 20 years is that now there is this idea that India is rapidly urbanizing, and so we need to invest, not make the mistakes of the past. So let's build the metros, let's build all the construction and so on. And I suspect that in many towns and cities of India, you're going to see what's happened in China. There is ghost towns. That is, you build the infrastructure, but there are no people. And you cannot imagine that happening in India because you're used to this idea that population is always growing. But it's not. In some parts of India, it's actually slowed down tremendously. So there is this fundamental, so I think one has to be very careful at people who are actually in this business of planning to really get a sense of the numbers of migration, for which you need good data on migration, not like this 8-year delay in release of numbers, some good data on fertility and so on. And unfortunately, I don't see many of the people who work in this space, and I'm interviewing many of them now, who actually have a grip on the actual numbers. So they work with the sense that, there's a lot of things happening, so we should make all this work. But I think getting a grip on the actual numbers is very, very important. It's an important part of that story. The second point is also well taken. I actually do have a chart in the appendix on service and manufacturing. But I would disagree with the proposition that earlier it was manufacturing, now it is service. I have a chart I use in my macroeconomics class. Services sector in India was already something like 20% of GDP in 1901. This is the Siva Subramanian series of national income 20th century statistics. There has never really been a case in India where manufacturing has done substantially better than services, if you look at a 100-year, 120-year time series today. So it begs the question, was there something fundamentally different happening before? Manufacturing, you're right, the growth rates have fallen off, but service growth rates were always there. It is also, you're also right in the sense, if you look at China as a comparison, China has absorbed much of this migration in manufacturing enterprises. India has failed to do that. So to that extent, yes, I mean, manufacturing does matter. The classic development process is, you know, agricultural sort of transfer of labor into manufacturing and then people developing skills there and then moving out into the
services. Yeah, my other point was that you've not disseminated into gross migration and net migration. So the reverse migration, and so there is possibly, I don't know if you have a way to say as to pinpoint that due to failure of agriculture, how many have migrated to towns, whereas our real experience shows that a huge number has over the last 10 years, but your data might not be gross and net in that sense.
Yeah, I mean, so we've done a lot of work on gross and net. There's a whole economic survey chapter which some of us drafted in 2016-17, which discussed, there's a whole box in that on definitions of migration, the problems of estimating migration flows and all. So there's no doubt that, and that's what you said, that gross flows are very large and net flows are small because there's a lot of circulation which happens. Circulation of many types, but you know, people tend to think of circulation as being only distress driven. There is some component of distress, but as I've shown, you know, this has been a phenomenon for more than 100 years. Circulatory migration in India is not a post-1991 phenomenon. You saw that chart on sex ratios of Ratnagiri and Udupi. It has been there for a long, long time. So there are new pockets of seasonal migration, which I also showed in the graph. But this broad idea of Great Indian Migration Wave is not distress. It is about networks. It's about peer pressure. It's about growing. It's a culture of migration. If you grow up in Ratnagiri, you are expected to move out and return. You know, it's not so much whether agriculture is doing well or badly, you go. For example, in Ganjam, it's a very rational situation because you know you're going to be hit by a super cyclone every 10 years. And in my book, I sort of note down the years in which it has been hit, you know. Last 110 years, on average, every 10 years is a super cycle. So migration is a very stable, rational strategy. That is, the whole economy is geared towards money from outside. Yeah.
But did we look at a data which spoke about migration due to, just one sec.
Yeah, sure. No, you have
15 minutes?
Yeah. Okay. We can take it offline.
So my question is, what do you think about the educated migrant and uneducated migrant? Because the educated migrant are not moving towards the village, but uneducated, your data is showing that they are not the net migrant.
Yeah. So there's no doubt that permanent migration rates are higher for across the education gradient, but you'd be surprised to know how many educated people also go back. In the pockets which I've talked about, it's pan caste. And you know, in my own family from Udupi, I mean, I showed you a thing on Udupi. I have a lot of family members who've gone back, you know, if not Udupi, you know, some parts close enough to Udupi. So that's why I'm trying to think that this idea of circulation is not just distress. A lot of it is based on literally a culture, you know, built in many of these places on going back. What I'll say is the story on education is very different when you look at gender. There's much more family-based migrations at sort of high education stream. That is why return migration is much lesser from the US than many other places, because you know, Indian migration to the US is the elite. There's a book called The Other 1%. It's the sort of elitist of the elite who go to the US. And so there we know that the permanent migration, return migration rates are much lower, partly because both sort of man, husband and wife are fairly educated. So this thing about, you know, the educated not going back, I don't think is very strongly borne out in the data. To the extent that there is relatively more permanent migration rates, it's not something to decry. I mean, across the world, societies become urban, and it's the most stylized fact of development. Unless all of us in this room are then, you know, ourselves are going to go back to a village. We're not. This room, I mean, this is what education does. So if you come to Azim Premji, you would have come from a variety of places. But I can guarantee you're going to spend your life not only in a city, but a big city of India. That is what agglomeration does. So that's you know, that's how skills tend to agglomerate in particular areas. And that's not necessarily a bad thing for an economy. There was a concern of brain drain from India, for example. Today, nobody talks about a brain drain. the 60s, 70s, it was a big cry. Why should the IITs, IIMs spend so much money, people going out? Today we don't. Why? Because we've realized the tremendous feedback value that through remittances, through networks, through alumni associations. So today IITs, IIMs love their alumni. They say, no, it's good that you went to US, now give us the money. So that's sort of a thing. The same relationship between IIT, IIM and a US is between a village and a town. Okay, so in Ratnagiri, where we studied this village, each village has a diasporic association in Bombay. And they are kind of using these links to get a sort of mobile tower being installed and so on. So this idea of remittances, you know, diaspora, philanthropy, is big within internal migration streams as well. So it's not necessarily a bad thing that educated people are not going back to villages. It's inevitable that people will conglomerate in certain areas.
I have two quick questions. I know that I don't want to take much time. Thank you very much for such an interesting talk, and I really look forward to reading the book. So I have two questions. One is that when you talk about a place like Sambal, where everything is based on fertility, I'm curious to know what is it that is actually supporting that type of a population growth. You know, that's one thing. Second thing is, I'm more concerned about psychological impact on the men as well as the women and children who stay back. You know, for example, when I was in Nepal, I heard that they would see their fathers once in 3 years, once in 5 years. So has there been anything in your own book or in your study, like how does it impact us as human beings, you know, moving so far away from our families? Yeah,
so
thank you.
Second question first. So, tremendous impact. I mean, it should not leave you with the thought that this is something that I support or I advocate. This is a phenomenon which I described. You know, ideally, I would argue that there should be more gender balanced migration. But this is a phenomenon. It does entail a lot of psychological burden. Women, there's one school of thought which says that such migration would lead to more female autonomy because women start taking more decisions in the household when men are away. Research shows that it depends. If the woman is in a nuclear household, then yes. But if it's in a larger household, like the average Indian household, then not much. And just the fact that in Bihar, you've had 100 years of this migration, and you don't see that much change, right? It tells you something. Some studies on Kerala, on psychological women's loneliness, a bunch of studies on that, men's loneliness too, men's loneliness outside, a variety of things. But even when I write in this book, the so-called Desperate Housewives, right, which is a famous series in the US, but a lot of the H-1B holders in the US are male, the H-4 holders, the dependent spouses in the US are female, about 100,000 of them. And as a result of which, it's not just women left behind, but even women who go, right, and who are locked out of labor markets, either because of visa laws or because the family doesn't allow or whatever. It's a tremendous source of brain drain, psychological burden. So I think at both ends, there is clearly separation. One of the chapters in the book starts with this famous song, "Mere piya gaye ro maan se kya telko mari yaad aati." That kind of encapsulates all the sort of pain of separation which most of these migrations entail. But you're right that Nepal, but you know the thing with Nepal, it's not just Nepal, it's the entire Himalayan economy. If you look at a map, it's Nepal, Himachal, Uttarakhand and even parts of Jammu and Kashmir which have become remittance economies. Okay, and all of them have roots in the military recruitment networks. So whether it's the Nepalese, recruited in the British Army, whether it's the people from Uttarakhand, particular regiments went around networks and from Uttarakhand to Delhi, for example, that's been documented how these networks started. But all of them, unfortunately, male-dominated, and continued. Yeah. Some question here.
Chinmay, yeah. We normally take three together, but I'll let them have their questions.
Yeah. So hello. My question is. How does the percentage of migrants in a city have an effect on the services provided by the metropolitan city or the municipality? And is there a difference between the welfare scheme provided by the municipality in different cities based on the percentage of migrants?
That's a very, very good question.
Answer. Yeah.
I'll go next. Yeah. Answer this. And I'll tie it in with what he had asked about Sambal. First, as a student, there's actually not much research, right, on this particular question, which means this is a great research topic. See, in India, cities actually don't really
see, you know, when you're providing a service, it's, there is an issue of domicile sort of clauses on who, so PDS for example, right? So migrants are locked out of many of these networks because, and that's one of the reasons people say there's not much interstate migration in India, because you lose your sort of access to basic services as you move. Migration and city government is a very interesting relationship. One, when cities have a high proportion of migrants, that's also usually a city which is doing very well economically, which means that the city government's public finances are nicely rising, which means that there's a lot of tax collections, there's a lot of, you know, buoyancy which happens. And so broadly put, government finances are in a better state when there are a lot of migrants out there, right? And that is why Surat has, you know, had a fantastic time, because the economy is booming. When the economy is booming, government's finances are usually, you know, doing very well. When the migration share is very low, for example, like in Samhal, okay, A, it's either, you know, not, it is not attracting much talent, etc. But then it becomes more challenging for the government to provide public services. Now, if it happens to be like Sambal, which is high internal growth, it's even more challenging because you don't have the public finances and you have to cater to a rising population. And the question on Sambal, you know, on internal growth, how does it really look? The demand for a lot of new space from industrial, so if you look at land use patterns, for example, they don't change very dramatically, okay, because there's not much migration. Land use patterns change dramatically when there's a lot of migration. So when there's only internal growth, you'll have some demand for housing stock, a lot of self-employment, the standard sort of urban informal economy. But apart from that, it's not as dramatic changes in the sort of urban space that you would see, you know, elsewhere. I don't know if that answers your question, but broadly, I mean, this is the kind of thing that I get when you look at cities growing only on internal growth. And as I mentioned, you know, there are two transitions happening. One is family sizes are becoming smaller, which means a lot of families now want their first house, which is outside their, you know, parental house. So that leads to demand for new housing. Okay, but if you have if you're at a high fertility level, you're also likely to be more a society which is still based on the joint system. So you have population growth, but you don't really have a demand for new housing stock because there are more people living in the same house. So it's not very clear as to how much more demand for new housing space is required in that space. And that is why if you look at area changes in internal growth cities, you don't see dramatic changes in reclassification of the town limits. It's only people, Bangalore, you know, you see the booming cities, every census period, they kind of resize the city in a big way. And that's because there's so much migration.
Thank you, Chinmay. That's an excellent, I mean, talk. I have many, many, many questions, but I'll keep them limited. One, quickly on the question of displacement as a mechanism that is throwing out people, and the fact of return isn't as clear-cut. Secondly, the role of technology in both mediating how close migrants feel back to their homes and what that means to their decisions to go back and forth, and also about settling in itself, the quality of settling in that happens because technology allows you to be insular. And carve out your own world, and which is very new compared to the earlier sorts of settlement that you saw where whole society was there to interact with in a way that you don't need to anymore, and the tensions that might come from that sort of a thing. Lastly, a normative question, you know, the kind of normative approval you seem to have towards city as a space that allows you to be creative in certain ways, can that be conjoined to another normative concern about how cities need to also be non-hostile to non-cities, and you know what the role of planning might be in that respect?
So, a lot of questions. I remember the last two. I'll come back on the first. Last one, I'll start backwards. On hostility, yes. I mean, I showed you that photograph of my family on that terrace, and we were neighbors of Bal Thackeray, you know, who's the most famous anti-migrant politician in India. In fact, we had to change our surname because of the anti-South Indian migrants wave. So, in the book, I talk more about this and displacement. But let me just quickly answer. I argue that there are three perspectives broadly. I call it a Thackeray perspective, a Gandhian perspective, and an Ambedkar perspective on migration, especially rural to urban migration. And the Thackeray perspective is very simple. It's nativist. It says, you know, are sons of the soil. We own this, and outsiders are sort of second claimants, and you know, they better behave. Gandhi is very interesting because he's in between. He wants village republics and, you know, cities, the worst creation of, you know, humankind, a lot of things on anti sort of urban this thing. But at the same time, he knows, you know, he has this spirit of cosmopolitanism, right? So he's very rich on that. In fact, I cite him, though I criticize his, many of his views in the book, he's also on record saying if the Harijans feel, you know, ostracized, they should leave and move to the city. So he's on record saying all those things and so on. And Ambedkar is, you know, completely the complete cosmopolitan, right? In fact, he's on record saying, you know, what is a city, what is a village? You have to move. This is the best thing to happen. Migration is the best thing to happen. So there are these three interesting sort of spectrums. And Gandhi is like the reluctant urbanist. You know, I mean, even the Sabarmati ashram, you know, or even the Vardha ashram, they were on the outskirts of the city, you know. So making you full use of the city's connection, not in the middle of nowhere. So the way I see, you know, so I definitely take a very strong normative position that migration, safe migration, is a very good thing. India needs more of it. India needs to urbanize more, not less. That's a very strong sort of stance I take, based on India's own experiences within states, as well as comparison with outside countries. On displacement, there's this slum in Mandala, called Mandala, near Tis in Mumbai. And they have, you know, I mean, they're almost like twice displaced, different development projects and displaced. There's undoubtedly that this is probably the group most affected negatively by the process of migration. There are very few groups that you can say have benefited from displacement. And those sort of harmful effects go on for generations. So again, the numbers are not hard to, very hard to come by. In my book, I do have a whole section on displacement. But we know that for a fact that since independence, there have been about more than 40 million people cumulatively who have been displaced, which is much more than the three partitions, that is partition of India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and so on. So no straight answers on that. It's just that it is an issue. It is an issue migration scholars shy away from because we don't know how to deal. There are no good numbers on it. But there's no doubt, especially in urban spaces, that the displaced are, you know, often the worst off. Again, depends on who are the displaced. For example, the partition refugee displaced a very different lot. So Delhi, Bombay, you know, that thing happened very differently. But especially the farmer displaced going to cities, it's really difficult to get a hold in the city. Relatedly, if the question is there upward mobility in cities? That's a big question. Or does the city actually dissolve caste identities? You know, my take is that obviously not. I mean, you have so much of, you know, inequalities in cities, but on especially in the basis of caste, I would argue that relatively, in relative terms, it's much, much better off than villages, right? So, for example, residential segregation. There's a study by IIM Bangalore which shows, you know, tremendous residential segregation in Bangalore on the basis of caste. You know, you have these residential segregation scores, and it's very high. But the average village in India is perfect. It's perfect segregation. It's 100% segregation. So, you know, it's moving from that complete segregation to very bad, but at least some space of moving around. Technology, you know, matters. But again, because many of these migrations have been going for so long, for me, it just seems that they kind of get the technology, they use it, but the essence of the phenomenon is still the same. So the Ganjami migrants didn't have mobile phones earlier. You know, they went to Rangoon, they used to write letters or send many of them illiterate, so they would send these telegraphic money orders and so on. They would get like a thumbprint on it. Today they have a mobile phone, they can send back money faster, etc. But the essence of the phenomenon, you know, has not seemed to change much. You're right in terms of entertainment, a lot of change. So if you see the classic, so a lot of my research for my PhD was on railway station platforms. And if you see what migrants, especially young migrants, are doing, they're on a phone, they're all huddled together watching, you know, something. And now with this free sort of internet, practically free internet, you know, huge spike in entertainment. What are they watching? They're watching stuff from the back. They're not watching Kannadiga, you know, Bihari migrant audience is not watching Kannadiga serials or something. Very rarely, it could happen, but very rarely. They're watching Bhojpuri movies, they're watching their own cultural sort of intimacy. To that extent, it could lead to more ghettoization, in the sense people are still within the confines. It's made it easier now. Just like Indians in the US, it's made it so you can get any In fact, I'm in Ahmedabad, I don't get many of the pickles you get here. And somebody from US said, you know, we get it here in the US as well. So it's easier now to connect back home. And in a very strange way, it might make you less invested in your destination, which may not be a very nice thing. I mean, you would ideally want to, you know, have people to be connected, yes, of course, with the source, but also invest a bit in Bangalore, understand Bangalore a bit more, and so on. And you cannot just have a situation where you say, you know, migrants can do whatever they want. I think there has to be some interaction with the place that they go to as well.
Clusters forming and them becoming the net receivers of migrations, or larger, smaller clusters of cities across the country? Say NCR, Delhi, NCR, Bombay, Bangalore becoming extraordinarily big coming forward, or many tier 2 cities in UP or something like that?
Has brought you here.
No. So, is there, I am also looking for research in this in Ratnagiri in terms of migration. So, it will be helpful for me. Thank you so much for this. So Ratnagiri has 9 blocks, but from every blocks, as per the census data, shows that the population is reducing. But the Dapoli, in the Dapoli block, means population are increasing, means in rural and urban area also. In urban area, it's increasing 120%. So how do you look this situation in one district?
Okay, so two last questions. So his question was, this is a classic question on city size distribution. Most planners, most idealists, everyone would say that ideally you should have, yes, you should have urban development, urbanization, but it would be nice if it was balanced. It would be nice if, you know, everyone got a chance, and, you know, it would be nice if Bangalore didn't become so big. Others would also sort of become. The historical evidence across the world suggests that that's usually not the case. There will be agglomeration, there will be some uneven development, and Bangalore will grow faster because it's big already, that sort of a thing. Of course, there'll be tipping points. Calcutta was a Bangalore 80 years back. It's not today. Today it's a city of decline in terms of population in many wards and so on. But in India, if you look at class-wise of cities, it is true that today's sort of top 10 cities, see, there's also a methodological different problem out here. If you look at just the big cities today and you compare its growth rates with the other distributions, you'll find that the big city growth rates today, they've grown quite fast. But that's because the big cities today are big because they grew very fast in the last 30, 40 years. So ideally, your study should look at 1901, you know, the full range of cities. And did those cities, how did they range over time? And when you see that, you realize there's so many. Kanpur was so big, you know, it's kind of fallen off of the sort of relative chart. Surat was one of the biggest cities of India in 1700. It went down, came up, all those things happened. Short answer today is, if you did this quick cut methodology, you would say that yes, the top biggest cities of India are growing faster than the rest. If you ask me, you know, normatively, what is my position? I would say that at least one city in every state should grow very fast, which is not happening. For example, the problem in India is, in Bihar, for example, you don't have any town which is growing as fast as other places. Okay, so ideally you would want Patna to grow very fast. So if at least one city in every state grew, then you don't mind Bangalore growing very fast, or, you know, Bombay or anything. But to the extent that we live in a, you know, union of states, and state level fiscal federalism is premised on states and union territories, it would be nice to have at least one big magnet in every city. And to that extent, maybe it makes sense to direct, you know, for example, the Nehruvian agenda was heavily based on, you know, regional balanced development. And to some extent, you know, it did work. Starting those plants and things around did get people there. But in the long run, it's some internal dynamic of the city which pulls it ahead. So Bhubaneswar is growing much faster than all the plants that they grew around in Odisha and so on. So it's a big question. I don't have any clear answers, but it's something that can be researched very, very nicely. On Ratnagiri and you know, this particular region, I'm not fully aware of this particular thing, so I should probably dig deeper. My sense is that particular parts of Ratnagiri is very interesting. Particular parts which have got some investment, some power plant, you know, some something or the other. Some have gone down, some have not. And that might be one of the reasons. But you know, what he's saying is very interesting, because Ratnagiri has been India's slowest growing district in terms of population over the last 80 years. And that's partly because at least a few people settle in Bombay, and you know, this massive out-migration which has happened. But I'd be happy to look into this further. I have not come across this. But as you know, the sex ratio is remarkable. It's like a Guinness Book of World Record. More than 1,100 for more than 100 years. It's a remarkable statistic.